is going to do something big in our lives, okay? Even in reference to this thing called the coronavirus, okay? Some people have been nervous, some people have been scared, some people have been worried about what is going to happen, what our future is gonna look like. When are we gonna go back to school? When are we gonna get to see our friends again? When are we gonna get to play and be around others and not have to use social distancing anymore, right? Some of us are a little bit concerned about that, but guess what? Even in reference to that, God's gonna do something big, okay? So if you haven't told maybe your sibling or your parent just yet what you learned so far, I want you to share with them that you have learned that God's gonna do something big. If you haven't learned anything else today, I'm gonna teach you something today, but if you don't learn anything else, you can say that you learned that God's gonna do something big, okay? So, as I said earlier, today, we're gonna be talking about the Easter story, right? So, we all know who Jesus is, and for you guys who may not know who Jesus is, don't worry, I'll teach you. So, there's a man named Jesus. He's the Son of God, and Jesus did lots of amazing things in his lifetime, right? He was a teacher, he was a preacher, he gave food to the hungry, he healed the sick, he did a lot of amazing things in his lifetime, but one of the greatest things that we honor God for is his sacrifice, dying on the cross for our sins, okay? So I'm gonna read a little bit of the story of Jesus dying on the cross for our sins. And it comes from Matthew, the book of Matthew. And if you have a Bible close to you or near to you, you can read along with me. And if you don't, it's okay, you can just listen, okay? And the best version for kids to read the Bible in is the ICB version, okay? So, we're gonna read Matthew chapter 26, verse 36. We'll probably go down to maybe verse 46, somewhere around there, okay? So this is when Jesus was praying in the Garden of Gethsemane. Everybody say, Gethsemane. That's kind of a funny word, but that was the name of the garden. The Garden of Gethsemane, okay? And it reads, it says, then Jesus went with his disciples, his best friends. He went with the disciples to a place called Gethsemane. And he said to them, sit here while I go over there and pray. He took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee along with him. Okay. So he took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee along with him, and he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, my soul is overwhelmed with sorrow, to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me. So he told his friends to go and pray with him. He was going to pray on his own, but he wanted them to pray in agreement for the things that he was going to be praying by himself with just him and God. That's important. So make sure you remember that when it comes to this story, okay? So he told them to stay there and pray. Going a little farther, he fell to his face to the ground and prayed, my Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken away from me. Yet not as I will, but as you will. Okay, so this is God. If it's possible that I don't have to die for everybody's sins, then I'll be cool with that. But if this is what I have to do, then if that is your will, I will allow for your will to be done. Okay. Then he goes on to say that he turned to the disciples, remember his friends, and found them sleeping. Could you men keep watch with me for 1 hour? So he said, y'all supposed to be my friends. Couldn't you pray for 1 hour with me? I just asked you to pray for 1 hour. You couldn't do that? Okay, so he was a little frustrated with them, but he leaves them and he goes and prays. So he went away a second time and prayed, my Father, if it's possible for this cup to be taken away from me, take it away, unless I drink. May your will be done. When he came back again, he found them, guess what? Sleeping again, okay? So he finds them sleeping because their eyes were heavy. So he left them and went once more, so this is the third time, to pray again. And we're gonna stop there, okay? So we see in the Garden of Gethsemane that Jesus was praying about what was going to happen next. So he knew that a time was coming, okay? So he knew the time was about to come that he was gonna have to make the ultimate sacrifice. who views this video sins, for your parents' sins, and everybody in your family, and anybody else you can think of, he died for their sins too, okay? So he was gonna have to make this big sacrifice of himself, but he knew that 3 days later he would rise again. So he wouldn't stay dead, but he would rise again 3 days later. So that was the good part of it, okay? So we read Matthew chapter 26, verse 36 through 46, okay? And my favorite part of that section of the story was when Jesus was praying, right? So Jesus decided, I'm not going to be selfish, but God, if there's another way, I think I would like to choose the second way versus the first way that you told me. But when you know that you have to do something, when you know that it's time to do something, you gotta do it. When your parents say it's time to go to bed, you gotta go to bed. When they say it's time to eat, you know it's time to eat. So when God says it's time for something, you have to know that whatever he asks you to do in that time is gonna benefit you, it's not gonna harm you, okay? So Jesus knew that his time was coming. So knowing that his time is coming, he took his best friends. Who doesn't love to hang out with their best friends? So he took his best friends, Peter, James, and John. Those are the two brothers, James and John. There we go. So he took his best friends right to the Garden of Gethsemane to pray with him, okay? Jesus knew that being Jesus Christ, that was his full name, he knew that being Jesus Christ wasn't going to be an easy job, right? Sometimes when you get assigned with an assignment, so sometimes your teacher will give you a classroom assignment as the line leader, or sometimes your teacher will say, you're the example today, set the example. Or sometimes you'll have the assignment of collecting all lunches. Whatever the assignment may be, you have to remember that you are the example. And because you're the example, sometimes that means that you have more responsibilities, right? And responsibilities can be a great thing, but also it can be a stressful thing sometimes. But remember, if God gives you the responsibility, it will never be too much. It may seem like a lot, but it will never, ever, ever be too much, okay? So Jesus knew that being Jesus Christ and having to die for people's sins was not going to be an easy job. You know, he knew that he probably would get a little scared. He probably would be a little bit intimidated by that big responsibility. So he knew that it wasn't going to be an easy job, but he had people around him to support him, to encourage him, and to tell him, Jesus, don't worry about it. You're doing the right thing. And if God said for you to do this, if he gave you this assignment, don't worry. That means you can totally handle it, okay? So Jesus decided to bring his best friends with him to do this big assignment. He knew his time was coming, and he decided not to be selfish, but to be selfless, which means to do something for somebody else and sacrifice maybe yourself for something that you enjoy to benefit somebody else. And sometimes God calls us to be selfless, right? We shouldn't be selfish. We shouldn't want to hoard things and just do things to benefit ourselves, but we should always, always, always choose the option that benefits us but also benefits someone else. And sometimes there's not an option that benefits you, but if your heart's in the right place and if you choose to be selfless, then God will honor that. He'll make sure that you're blessed because you were a blessing to someone else, okay? So Jesus decided that he was going to be selfless, not selfish, but selfless, okay? And so he made this decision to go through with the original plan that God had, okay? So let's take a moment to talk about what it was time for, okay? So as we look at what Jesus was doing in the Garden of Gethsemane, we know he was praying, but in his brain, when he was praying, he knew that it was time. Everybody said, it was time, okay? So he knew that it was time. And what was it time for? I'm glad you asked. I'm going to tell you what it was time for. One, it was time to pray. But not pray and worry. Pray and leave it there, okay? So it was time to pray. So one lesson that we can learn from Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane is when we are in a tough situation, we should not worry. We should not fret. But we should know that it is time to pray. Everybody say, it's time to pray. Great. So we should know that it is time to pray. And sometimes doing that by yourself gets a little difficult. And just like Jesus, he took his friends with him. And you know your true friends because they'll be willing to pray with you. Okay? They'll be willing to agree with you in what you are praying for. They're not going to convince you to go against God, but they're going to tell you to stay in the will of God, and they're going to come with you, even if that means that they got to stay up when they're sleeping, right? Those are your true friends, the ones who will come into agreement with what God told you to do, okay? Even if God didn't tell them to do it, if he told you to do it, you got to do it. But hopefully, you have good friends with you or around you who will pray with you so that you can continue to do what God asked you to do, okay? The second thing is, Jesus knew it was time to realize what was important, okay? Jesus knew that it was not time for fun and games. It was not time to joke around. It was not time to be silly, but it was time to think about what is important, okay? Important means what truly matters, right? Some things, little arguments, little fights, who sits in the chair first, who gets to be line leader, those things are small things, and those are not important. But things that God has called you to do, like to pray for others, right? To be kind, to be peaceful, to be slow to anger, those are things that are important, okay? Those are things that God called us to do. So we have to make sure that we remember what's important and what's not important, okay? Sometimes when we want to fuss and fight and argue, we're arguing about things that are not even important. Those things don't matter. In the next 5 minutes, in the next 10 minutes, maybe the next 15 minutes, those things won't even matter. So Jesus said, let me think about what's really important. Let me not get frustrated, let me not get angry. But first, number one, let me pray. And number two, let me think about what's really important, what really matters, okay? Even in times of being scared and fearful, Jesus knew that I still have to remember what's important. I can't just let myself go with fear or be taken away by fear or even be taken away by crazy thoughts in my head. I have to remember what is important. What has God already told me to do, right? And the most important thing that Jesus knew he had to do was die on the cross for our sins. Because he knew that 2,000 years later, which is today, we would need him. We would need to think about the sacrifice that he made for us. We would need to be encouraged when we are in a pandemic called coronavirus. So we would need him, okay? The third thing that Jesus thought about and realized that it was time for was to give God his props, okay? We had to give God his props, right? We had to shout out God for having a plan to prosper the world. Not just Jesus, not just his friends, not just the other 12 disciples, but the whole world. Like, God has a plan to prosper you, to have an amazing future, to bless you, for you to be in perfect peace. God has an amazing plan for you, right? And Jesus had to die on the cross so that we would have access to the plan. Because sometimes we as people don't always make the best decision. But because Jesus Christ died on the cross for us, every bad decision that we make, or every sin that we do or commit, it's already been forgiven. Like, oh, you sinned? Forgiven, right? So Jesus knew that the sacrifice that he made 2,000 years ago would be beneficial for us today and forevermore. Not just for us, but for everybody, forever and ever and ever and ever and ever, okay? So Jesus had to think on one, he had to remember that it was time to pray. Two, he had to remember that it was time to think about what's truly important. And three, he had to remember, it's not about me, but I gotta give God his props because he set this up. This was a part of my future, and I want to please God. I want to make God proud of me. I want to show him that I care about what he asks of me, and I want to do exactly what he has asked. So I got a challenge for you. I want you to think about this. So everybody knows what emojis are, right? Right. So when God thinks about you, what three emojis would he use to describe you? Would he use the heart eyes emoji? Would he use the frowny face emoji? Would he use the thumbs up emoji? When I think about what emojis God would use to describe me, I'd say he would use the heart eye emoji because he loves me so much. And when he looks at me, he's like, I just love her so much. Even when I make bad decisions. Even when I don't always listen to him. Even when I get mad or frustrated with God, loves me just for that, okay? So that's the first emoji. The second emoji I think God would use to describe me is a flashlight. The flashlight, okay? Because when people feel dark, when they feel sad, I try to bring light or happiness or joy to any situation. So I think he would use a flashlight. And the third emoji is the lock, but it's locked and sealed and closed. Because me and God, we're locked in like this. He's my best friend, I'm his best friend, and we're locked down, okay? So those are my three, the heart eye emoji, or the OG, the flashlight, and the lock, okay? So what I want you to think about right now, what three emojis would you think God would use to describe you? Okay, if you've thought about it, great. Now think about the emojis that you want him to describe you as. So maybe you don't want him to use the angry emoji, so you want him to use the smiley face emoji. This is going to help you decide and start to navigate through what you may need to work on so that we can always be pleasing to God, okay? So overall, being a Christian, we've learned that it's not always easy. Sometimes we have to make tough decisions, but it's better to be centered around Christ, which is what it means to be a Christian. It's better to think about the plans and the future that God has for you than to do the opposite, right? We don't want to be cringe, okay? Or we don't want to insult God by not doing what he's asked us to do. And we don't want to insult God by not being obedient. We don't want to insult God because he created us. When we were formed in our mother's womb, he said, your name's going to be this, and you're going to look this way, and I'm going to say, look at you and say, oh my gosh, I did such an amazing job creating this person, and I have a hope and a future for them. They're going to have an amazing future. That's what God said when he created you. So it's an insult. It hurts God's feelings when we go away from God, don't listen to him, we don't listen to his word, our Bible, when we don't gather ourselves around people who love God just like we love God, it hurts God's feelings, and it's kind of cringe too. So we want to make sure that we always, always, always cling to God and lean on God when we need him. That we remember that in tough times we need to pray to him, because that's what time it is. It's time to pray. In tough times we need to just get on our knees and pray. Say a quiet prayer to yourself, but don't forget to pray. In tough times, we need to remember the important things. Remember what God says to do, and remember what matters and what doesn't. And also, we need to give God his props, because he knows all, sees all, and he can do all. So we got to give God his props in tough times. Okay, guys? So that's it for Story Corner today. That was our story. The portion when Jesus was in the Garden of, let me see who remembers. If you say Gethsemane, you're right. In the Garden of Gethsemane, when he prayed to God, to ask God to take away the fact that he had to die on the cross, but if you didn't take away that fact, if you said, I'm still going to do it, he was willing to be selfless and do it for all of our sins, okay? And another thing that I think about when we talk about the Easter story, truly with Easter, I think about communion. And for some of us, we take communion. Some of us have never heard of communion before. And some of us, we've taken communion. But communion simply just represents, prior to Jesus praying, he had a fancy dinner, okay? And they had bread, and they had something to drink. And during this fancy dinner that they had, Jesus was telling his friends, called the disciples, he was telling them about what the future holds for everybody. So what was going to happen, that he was going to die on the cross, and his friends were like, what are you talking about? You're so silly. We don't believe you. You're making up stories right now. But what he was saying was totally the truth. But he was trying to prepare them so they knew that what was coming up, okay? And especially on Easter, we do this as often as you desire to do it, but especially on Easter, we think about that Last Supper, that dinner that they had called the Last Supper, because that helps us remember and think about how appreciative of Jesus we are for dying on the cross for our sins. So, after this video is over, I want you to have a replica of the Last Supper, which will find some bread and find something to drink and do it with your family, do it with your sibling. But I want you to take communion so that you show that you are so appreciative to Jesus for what he did, okay? Don't forget. forget, you gotta do communion, and you gotta challenge your family to do it with you. And you are responsible for explaining to them what it means, okay? Okay, guys, so that's all we have today for today's YouTube episode of All Nations Kids Easter Whiteout Service. If you're watching this, if you wanna go throw on a white shirt, if you wanna throw on some white pants, if you wanna throw on some white tennis shoes, be my guest to join us in our All Light. And we are so excited that you have viewed and joined. And even if you're listening to everything that we've said today and you've decided, I want to commit my life to Christ. I want to give my life to Christ. I want to make sure that every decision that I make, God is pleased with. You can do that by commenting below, Jesus is my Savior, okay? If you can't spell that, just write Jesus in the comment section. We want you to flood the comments with how much you love God and how much you care about God. So whatever you know how to spell, whether it be Jesus, whether it be I love you, God, whatever you have in your heart and in your capability, go ahead and write that in the comment section, okay? That's all we have for you today. Thank you guys for tuning in, and we'll see you next time. Bye, guys.